I mean, I could explain how to make PCBs. It's not very hard. You need to have some basic understanding in electricity, electronics though. I guess I could make a new project. Yeah, well, I suppose we're taking... Oh, you mean AI-03? Oh, but AI-03's guy was easier to understand though than Master Zen. Master Zen is like way more difficult to understand. Okay, I guess we could make a new project. Okay, so this one I just call it a tutorial stream. Yeah, yeah, that's the thing, Josh. Low-level programming is like... The documentation is like... They assume you know a lot of things already, which is terrible for anyone trying to learn. Are people at OSDEF really that egotistical? Huh. Alright, so when you start a project, you need to have the schematic. So... I recommend using the latest version of KiCad. Don't use the old one. The old one that is recommended in the guide is very outdated. So, first things first, we're going to need to have a... Oh, wow, okay, this is really big. Okay, this is wrong. Okay, here we go. You know the basics. What basics? Unironically, I had to spend a solid few hours learning how to read the Intel x86 documentation. Oh Jesus, that's really bad. No. The guide tells you to download an older version, but you shouldn't. Alright, so after that, you go to GitHub. It's marbastlib. Yeah, this one. So this is a very good library. The one used in the guide. It's very old. It makes you download multiple of them, but you don't need that anymore. And hey, welcome to the stream, Melonhead. Alright, so you just need to download marbastlib. And then after that, you... I'm just going to go to manage symbol libraries. Okay, so I have marbastlib here already in another PCB, so I'll just copy-paste it over. Okay, so under... tutorial stream. Alright, here we go. So, marbastlib. Now I'll go to project specific libraries. Here. And then go this one. And then click on MX symbol. And then on various symbol. And then, okay. Oh, okay, that should be loaded. Alright. So press A to open up this thing. So today we're going to use Odd Mega because it's easier. So I think I'll use Odd Mega. I'm quite familiar with 32U2 actually, so I'm just gonna use 32U2. A and M. I can't remember the difference. Oh, wait, no. I'll use this one, QFN. You can see the difference between the footprints here. I'll be using the QFN footprint. So here we go. I did it using git code or something. Yes, you can technically do everything in like Git, but it's like, if you're not gonna upload it to GitHub anyway, you don't really need to do that. you can use Git bash to download like stuff really quickly. Like I can open up Git bash here, and then I can use git clone https github.com/e. I think his name is eblaster. Ebastler, and then marbastlib. Yeah, so it'll clone it into it. So it's just a different way of downloading things quickly. I should buy an Upmega and try to program it. Go for it. It's not the Upmega data sheet, at least, is not very difficult to understand. Okay, no, it's actually quite a pain, but it's not that bad. Okay, so the first things first, the obvious one we need to do is we need to connect all the VCCs to VCC. Is it VCC though? Wait, let me check. Let me just steal the schematic from my other project. Okay, let's see this one. Oh wait, it's 5V. Okay, that makes sense. Right. I shouldn't use VCC. 5V, because if direct VCC is not very safe. Because, alright, so basically what happens is that, let me just get out MS Paint. So when you have a USB port, they have a few pins, and one of those pins will be VCC. So this is like legit like direct voltage and current from your computer. So the port. So usually what happens is that you want to make this go through a fuse, because this way you can get a 5V current directly. You could connect it directly to VCC, but the fuse basically protects the rest of the circuit from, well, if this thing spikes or shorts or anything. So you want to have a fuse. Anything before the fuse is considered VCC, anything after the fuse is considered 5V. Okay. VCC is oh man, I actually don't know what it means. Okay, VCC means, oh no, electronics. Common collector voltage. Positive supply voltage for an integrated circuit. Okay, so it's like, it's also like 5V. It's the like the main voltage. Hey, welcome to stream, Melody. Okay, then the easiest one here, we can connect the ground. Okay, so W. Okay. If I'm not wrong, UCAP was connected to a 10K resistor. You can actually check the data sheet for that. Okay, hot mega 32 U2 data sheet. I love googling something and when it comes out with acronym, I wasn't trying to know the slightest. Yep, that basically happens so much. Alright, so UCAP. UCAP. Alright, here we go. Should be connected to an external capacitor. Alright, so it says in the data sheet here that it should be connected to external capacitor of 1 microf. So here we're going to go and add a C small. Oh. Ah! Typos. Okay. Okay, here we go. I'll just connect these together. And I believe that the end of this should be ground. Okay, so, and then press E to edit this. We're gonna put 1 UF. Teaches ASMR? Wait, what ASMR? How come it has 3 input voltage inputs and 2 ground inputs? That's a good question. I never really thought about it actually. I just figured when it came to microchips. Okay, this is like, do not quote me on this. I have no idea. This is just me trying to figure it out with this some convoluted way of guessing. So if you look at the packages here, you can see there are multiple pins for VCC. Okay, so there's probably a difference between AVCC and UVCC. Difference. I just assumed that they have different pins for powering the entire thing. VCC is used to power digital components. AVCC is used to power all analog components. Okay, that makes sense. Okay, that makes a lot of sense. Okay, so yeah, because the Omega is able to power analog devices as well. If not, encoders will not work. You know, the knobs. Yeah, knobs use analog. I imagine that's the same for U ground and the normal ground. I think AVCC is different from VCC. I have no idea, but they probably all do different things. And it's best to connect all of them. But since there are three... there are three VCCs, which means that we need 3 decoupling capacitors. Each each VCC needs a capacitor running right through it. What's this PCB for? No, I'm just teaching how to make PCBs. Can you explain what you're doing? Not a problem. I'm making a PCB. I'm teaching how to make a simple keyboard. Because Kura had issues understanding. Okay, so X-tal means crystal. So basically, when in microcontrollers, there's like a clock, right? So, oh man, I don't know how to explain what a clock is. A clock is, think of like, it processes things. Like think of like polling. I think that's how clocks work. It's like, parses data in like a time duration. And for crystal, how microcontrollers get their timing is it should be through the crystal, because the crystal is it's a component that like I have no idea what the fuck I'm talking about. Okay, what is a crystal oscillator? I know a crystal oscillator is like it makes sure that the timing of the microcontroller is on time. That's what it's for. Yeah, one clock cycle is one instruction processed. Yes, but the clock makes sure that the time is like on time, I think. Yeah, this is way above my school stuff. Yes, it is. I think working with extremely low level stuff like this, it might be actually stuff you learn in university. Yeah, it's like polling basically. Frequency matching can be a headache, very much so. I'm so glad that like data sheets, if you look at the data sheet here, it'll tell you what the crystal is supposed to be. All right, so wait, this is a little too zoomed in. 150. Okay, I think it tells you, let's look for the crystal, because in the data sheet somewhere it does tell you what megahertz I used. Yeah, so here it says that the frequency range of the oscillator. And you can see the max here is 16. You have to use either 16 or 8, I believe. So it's 16. What am I doing? I am teaching people how to make PCBs. Okay, so 16 megahertz. Which means that we need a 16 megahertz crystal. But this is something you deal with in the bomb, to be honest. Alright, so I'll just add a crystal here. Okay, so 23 small, because we are going to be... This crystal has 4 pins, if I'm not wrong, yes? Shit, I forgot how to wire up the crystal, no lie. Okay, I think this is how you connect it, like here. And then you have 2 capacitors to ground, so we need to put ground here. Or is it the other way? Oh man, I need to find like my I need to check. Oh my god. Okay, Oh, I was correct. Hell yeah. Yeah, the crystal is hard to wire. Okay, I'm just going to be lazy and just should I move it? I could move it, I guess. All right, we'll move it. Okay. So press H to create a hierarchical label. So I'm going to put this XR1. So, oh, whoops. Control H, I believe. Control H? Or is it Shift H? XR1. Nope. I think I'm just going to click here. Global label, yeah. XR1. Alright. So I'm just going to put this here. Going to move this. XL2, and then I'll just copy this here. So this way is like a teleport, like a portal. Yeah, that's like the best way I can put it into words. It's like a portal. So we'll connect these two together. And oh my. Okay, I'm just gonna move this. This thing here is taking up so much goddamn space. I'll just put it up here. I checked Wikipedia for quick crystal oscillators are useful for being a metronome for a design, so the instructions are executed on time. Yeah, I guess my scuffed explanation was basically. Alright. My brain is exploding. Oh no, is it really that complicated? I want to make it as easy as possible for you guys to understand. Oh no. Okay, so... here we go. I'll connect these. So, the crystals are... I don't know what the crystal itself does, but when you put a crystal with two capacitors together, it makes it a crystal oscillator. And I imagine what happens is that since capacitors hold charge in a certain way and then it releases that charge, it does it charging and releasing creates like a timing. I don't quote me on this. That's how my basic understanding of electronics is doing. Electronics are just naturally complicated. It's very possible that I found this less daunting to understand because I did study electronics in school for like a module or something. Oh, did I connect this correctly? It looks really scuffed. Let's see. Oh no, I connected it completely wrong. Okay, that's wrong. These two are supposed to be connected to ground. Okay. I'm on top of the world because of you. Oh, this one's such a banger, guys. Alright, actually, can you guys even hear the music? Okay, this tool here is connected to ground. Okay, this is the crystal. Check general. What do you mean general? You mean on trash can? Yeah, I'm confused. I don't know. There's no music. Wait. Can you guys not hear the music? Huh. I love these kinds of things, but nobody re-explained to me while I was doing my project. Now I understand what everything did. Oh, what was your project? Okay. Alright, so we have the crystal down. And this will be our D traces. I believe our data traces, according to the data sheet, requires a resistor of... okay, wait. I believe that in Atmel here, they have one section that like legit tells you what to do. It was the best practices, I think. Practice? No. Oh no, this is the software part. Okay. Oh wait, I think it was design practices. Nope. Oh my god, like, yeah, when I was designing on Omega 32U2 the other time, I was like, I had to read, like, all the hardware parts of this. It was really long. Like, not everything is useful, but you have to look out what is required. Okay, so this is the basic overview. We made a robot for a competition. Oh wow, what was it running? And, I still don't understand how people make robots, honestly. Okay, it was somewhere. Where is the best practices? It was down here. Like at the end of the hardware design. Then you have like a summary of what you should do. It was very useful. There are a lot of very useful libraries that make you not have to manually program a servo. Oh, I see. Power on reset, watchdog reset. References. Oh my god, what am I looking at? Okay, right now we're on which page? USB controller, memory programming, package information. Oh my. Overview? Block diagram, pin diagram. Interrupts IO port. Oh my god, I can't find it. Register summary. Oh no, typical characteristics. No. Yeah, ordering information. The speed here. Yeah, it says the speed here actually. Yeah, 16 megahertz, which means that that's for the crystal. Holy shit. Shit, this is confusing. I mean, I didn't see anything happening in general. Nothing much. I think it was like a 22 ohms. So let me search 220. Nope. What was it? It was... Oh, 22, not 220. Whoops. Okay, 22. Oh my god, that's quite the number of matches. Okay, let me just search data. Traces. Data trace. Oh, that's a lot of matches. Oh my god. Okay, I can't remember where it was. It was somewhere. Hey, Mai. Let's design a light. Oh, lights are very easy to program. Well, they're not easy to program. They're easy to put down. As long as you make sure that... Oh my god. Yesterday, I was like looking up this shit. I was like... I think you guys can see... oh, no, that's not it. I was looking at this yesterday. I had to read the data sheets for these, and I was wondering how to calculate the operation current for everything, depending on how many I put down. I had to make sure that my LEDs don't blow. This is so... feels so relaxing, yet the music's so hardcore. No, I love this song. The same nightmare. I hate how easy it is to short an LED. Oh yeah, I agree. It was somewhere. Shit, okay, I'm just gonna expand everything and see if I can find it. No, not memory. Oh wait, no, it wasn't in this sheet. It was in Omega 32U4, which was similar to 32U2 in the way you write it. Okay, let me show you. This is most definitely a bop of some sort. Okay, it was best. I think it was under design. Ah, design guidelines. Here we go. It's not in 32U2. So, zero resistance on USB data lines must be on 22 ohms. Yeah, this is because I guess I don't know what people who were designing the 32U2 were doing. It's the same deal. Well, they're not exactly the same, but they're similar. Okay. But basically, you gotta like check, see example wirings of other people, and you'll be able to see what they're doing basically. Okay, wait. I'm getting like distracted by the music. 32U2, the design is very similar to the 32U4. Oh, right, the example was teaching 32U4. This is 32U2. So the components are a bit different. Because there's only 3 VCC pins, there are less decoupling capacitors. Alright, and now for the reset button. This one is not too bad, so I gotta write a switch. So I guess it's... I believe it's push switch. I think, was it SW push? Yeah, there we go. So, W. And then, I gotta copy the ground over. If I'm not wrong, this is a pull-up resistor. Which means that, it requires a pull-up resistor. So, okay, when it comes to electronics, it's very, okay, when it comes to electronics, you would think that, like, to a computer, a robot, you would be like, 1 equals yes, and 0 equals no. So when you, so this is an active high, they call this active high. So, the opposite is called active low, I believe. So which means that 1 equals no, and 0 equals yes. So, I believe this is an active low, which means that you have to put a resistor here. I think, yeah. So, I can't remember what the resistor was. What value was it? Man. $10,000, I see. And it's connected to 5V. Oh, here comes the banger. I gotta put the music up. Yeah, so we're done with all the extra stuff. Except that we should still put down our decoupling capacitors. Alright. So here, design guidelines. UCAP, 1 microwave. 10 UF recommended for V-Bus. Alright. Hey, welcome to the stream! Rosen is here. This song? This is the best thing ever. So good. No lie, the resolution of the song, like the 4x3 aspect, makes it like a perfect song to put into the X. Alright, so we can see, alright, okay, sadly I'm going to have to pause the music a bit. This one is important and it's definitely the most confusing one. Alright, first time I've seen you stream on this channel, yeah, the song is really good. Yeah, well, I stream sometimes on this channel, sometimes, when I don't feel like being entertaining. Okay, so the really important thing we're going to learn right now is decoupling capacitors. So decoupling capacitors is a... oh man, I don't know how to explain this concept. Someone else explained it on YouTube way better than I did. You can look it up. I believe they have... it's this one here. YouTube.com decoupling capacitors. Yeah, so this one, decoupling capacitors. If you want to understand what decoupling capacitors are and what they do, this is going to explain what they do, okay? I'm waiting for Kasao to hit my local arcade so I can jam to odd loop and odd wait. Holy shit! Okay, I'm going to go to the arcade tomorrow. Holy shit! Yo, this thing is perfect on 2DX. It's a 9. I'm going to do my best to clear it now. Yeah, thank you. My brain just overloaded right now. I'm so sorry. Is it too difficult to understand? Oh no. Like, basically, I've explained what crystals do, which is make sure that the microcontroller stays on time with its clock cycles. And the D plus D minus, I actually have no idea why they need resistors. The data sheet said so, so you just do that. And the switch, the reset button. Okay, so basically what happens is that if the reset receives a 0, it will become reset. In electronics terms, you might be able to understand that whenever there's a line on top of something, it means it's an active low. So a good way to put it is that, so if I have don't save, if I have a like a X, so if X gets a 1, X equals true, which also known as yes. But then if you have an X over it and a line, they call it not, it will be equal, if it gets a 1, it will be false. Because what this line does is that it flips 1 and 0, because that's what a not does. If you know Minecraft, I believe this is what you call a not. This is, so if you have this is the input, and then this is the output. So if you put a 1 here and it goes through a NOT gate, it will turn into a 0. This is in Minecraft as well. Yeah, this is Boolean logic, yes. Is there like a tutorial on this kind of stuff? Oh man, the problem with these is like the tutorials are scattered everywhere. To know what you need to know, it's very difficult to find like a textbook that explains every single thing you need. to live stream to my YouTube homepage. One is Tokaku Easy Pick. Hey, welcome to stream. All right, so since this is an active low circuit, it requires a pull-up resistor to get... So when you press this button, it will send a zero here, which would trigger the reset. So you will reset the entire microcontroller. This is how you flash firmware. I don't know PCB stuff, but I'm amazed at your knowledge on this. Oh no, I barely know anything. I just made sure to understand enough to get this working. I need for literal 4 kids versions of this. Oh no, but I'm explaining this in as simple as possible right now. Okay, okay, so then as for everything else here, these are all just your input-output pins. They can do different things. If you look at the data sheet, you should be able... Oh wait, this is the wrong one. Whoops. somewhere. I actually like scrolled away from the best design practices. Okay, design guidelines. Okay, here we go. Yes, I totally understand everything. Well, if you won't hear it from the start, it might be hard to understand. The Minecraft equivalent of a NOT gate is a redstone torch. Yes, Minecraft uses a lot of logic gates. Zeshi told me that, you know, he would be really curious to see what I would make in Minecraft if I actually did play Minecraft. I think I would be one of those engineering Minecraft builders, the engineers. But I don't play Minecraft, too bad. And that's because I have most simulation sickness. I get dizzy when I play Minecraft very easily. Alright, Oh, I wouldn't be surprised if there's an online logic gates website. It's not too difficult to program something up like that, I imagine. Because it's... gates? You think Mumbo Jumbo knows about PCB designing? Huh? What? Okay, right, so I wanted to explain about the pins. So let's look at a pin diagram. So these are the different ports. It will explain what each port does. So these are all internal pull-up resistors. So think of how everything here, imagine every single thing inside of this microcontroller has this here already. So that's why you don't need to connect it to here, because these are all active low already. Yeah. What's your plans with the PCB designing? I need to fix my previous PCB because the lights are not working on this. Yeah, so the LEDs are not working on this. The in-key LEDs. The underglow works, the in-key isn't working. I need to fix that. Oh, to explain the confusing question by Chris, the Mumbo Jano is a famous Minecraft redstone engineer. Oh, I see. That's cool. Don't need join button win. Technically, I could actually... Wait, am I even able to, like, enable membership on this channel? Because I honestly think that more people would be interested in putting membership on this channel over Tokaku for whatever reason. Hey, welcome to stream, Burns. Okay, okay, so this is 8-bit bidirectional, and port D can be used as analog input. I see. So, but the thing is that right now we are designing something that is digital only, because we're going to use switches. And for port D, it's we're not going to use any analog. So I guess, I imagine that if you are going to put a knob on this thing, encoders, knob encoders, you would be using port D. Yeah. Okay, but since we're just using data, digital data, we can use everything here. Did they explain what B does? Okay, so port B also has special features here. Alright, 74. Yeah, they have all different stuff here. Unless you're using them, you don't need them. Yeah. Reject Tsukaku, return to blank. Hey, welcome to stream, guys. Yeah. Okay, then, since everything here is all done, we can just wire up the inputs, but we are not doing that just yet. we will have to deal with decoupling capacitors, right? I wanted to explain that. Okay, so I already showed you guys the video that you should watch if you want to understand decoupling capacitors. But basically, what decoupling capacitors do is that they... How do I put this? Oh, wait. D plus D minus shouldn't go to ground. What the fuck am I doing? No. Really wrong. Let me just copy paste this here. Maybe a D plus because I'm moving it somewhere else. Oh wait, no. D minus. D minus. And this one is D plus. Alright. Okay. So decoupling capacitors, they help decouple the VCC to make sure that they get a more consistent VCC input. I think that's what it does. I can't remember what the exact explanation was. Please watch that video. I like secondary channels of people because usually what they want to do instead of appealing to an algorithm. Yep, pretty much. Encoder uses digital signals too. You use an analog pin if you're using a potentiometer. Right. There's a difference. I forgot. Okay. Knob encoder. And then there is also a potentiometer. They're two different things. I forgot. They're both really similar. Oh. Lol. Okay. Anyways, let's work on the VCC. So we should put in our C small. If I'm not wrong, each pin should get their own capacitor, which means that we should have three of these. And I think the amount we're using is one UF. So I think three here. And then the next one would be, we're gonna add an extra one because according to the best design practices, the design guidelines, it says that the V-bus line, which is the line coming out of, going into here, should have a 10 UF capacitor. I believe that is correct. Oops, here we go. And let me double check. Did I do it correctly? Oh, wait, no. Okay, it's not one extra. It's one less. Okay, so two. So the total should just match up with the amount of VCCs here. So for example, if you're using an Omega 32U2, 32U4. Here we go. You can see that this has... Wait a second. Is this the correct one? Whoops, I can't remember. I remember it was like Omega 32U4. Was it the A version? Huh. Could have sworn for U4 they had four VCCs. I might be going insane. Okay, you know what? Let's go check AI03's guide. Okay, I think AI03's guide uses a 32U4. How many decoupling caps did he add? He added four. Zero point UF by each VCC pin. Okay, wait. No, there's no decoupling here. Okay, 0.1 UF. Okay, why do we have to use the micro F? 1 UF? Ha! Wait a second. That's confusing. Wait. Is it really 1 UF? Or is it 0. Oh, wait, I put 0.1. Okay, it's 0.1. Yep, 0.1. It looks okay. I just discovered a mistake from my previous project, actually. The prototype, even though it worked, I was missing one decoupling capacitor, it seems. I wish I could super chat to the brilliant tutorial channel. I wonder if there's any donation sites. Please don't. Okay. Tokaku, I'm sorry, but I don't understand at all. Well, I'm being confused myself, so it's understandable. Alright, okay, so I believe each, yeah, I was correct earlier, so each pin requires their own decoupling cap. And for whatever reason, I messed up in my previous design here, I only put 3. Is that even okay? So, yeah, I messed up there in my previous one. Wait, no. Yes, yeah. Okay. Yep. Wait. Official, wait, there's four VCC pins on the 2U4. Wait, but there's only... One, two, three. Oh wait, they have a V-bus pin. Okay, that explains a lot. Okay, no. So I was correct in my previous one. Since this one doesn't have V-bus, there's only 3 VCC pins, which means there are 3, you need to use 3 decoupling caps in total. So I'll just connect these together. And then connect these here and this here. Okay. It's like if my boyfriend started talking about PC and specs while I'm over here on console not understanding a single bit but entertained. Have you ever considered making your own rhythm game controller like Project Diva or 2DX? I considered making a mini 2DX controller. But yes. Right now I'm a bit preoccupied making like keyboard PCBs. For me, I just do stuff and it works. Then I go about my day not understanding what I did. That's pretty much what's happening with my PCB design right now. I mean, I try my best to understand, but I do not fully understand. Okay, so... Alright, let's see. Okay, so we have our decoupling caps here. We can make this look neat by using a line. So we can just draw a line around here. And then we can draw a line here to make everything look neat. I'm going to move this a bit further back so we have more space by those pins here. Let me just move this upwards here. Alright. So here we have our microcontroller area. There we go. Hey, welcome to stream, Ash. I've been getting the Project Diva again and oh man. Project Diva, I'm quite tempted to buy it on Steam. I saw the Steam version came out and it's by far, I honestly think hands down is probably the most superior Project Diva version. Like it's better than straight up piracy of any sort, because the Steam version of Project Diva, you can like unlock the frame rate to over 60 frames per second, and that puts it better than every other version of Project Diva out there. Yeah, Project Diva's on Steam now. Oh wow, it's the bots. Let me just like hide user on channel. Oof. What the fuck? Why are they spamming like that? Bruh. Okay. Alright, so next up, we are going to add a USB-C. If not, then how else are we going to be able to... connect it to the computer? So I'll be using the 2.0 version, because it's smaller. So the V-bus, this will be connected to our VCC here. Which means that I believe we put a fuse here. So I'm going to put down a polyfuse. And if I'm not wrong, the value for our polyfuse that is rated for... this is rated for USB-C and USB devices. It's 500 milliamps. this is how much USB-C likes. I guess you would find out by looking into find this value by looking into USB-C data sheets. Do you know someone named Token? No. Yeah, the Prodiva Steam is probably most likely keyboard compatible. Frame Unlocker needs a mod, right? Yeah, but think about it. Every other Prodiva game, you can't mod it to even get a bigger frame rate. Alright, so... Oh my god, this is very confusing. Yeah, VBus, Polyfuse? Yep, correct. Yeah, ground. VBus. Yep. C. Yep. That's that epic. Okay. I assume the CC is like... I have no idea what the C and C means, but you have to put it through an ESD. I use micro B instead of USB-C because I'm lazy to switch. After learning how to route USB-C, I prefer using it. It's not too bad, but the problem with USB-C is that it generally takes up a lot more space on a PCB, especially if you're trying to go for something small. Alright. Okay, so D+, D-, I believe. Yeah, I think you connect these two together because they're both the same thing. And then after that, you connect it to these here because it's going directly to... Oh. It's going directly to the... These are the data traces. So the data from... The C port goes into the microcontroller. Yep. The two data traces. And C goes to... they call it the ESD protection. This one is called the SRV04. This is the one that I use. I forgot how to use this. I need to reference the diagram. Oh my. I forgot how to use this one. Okay, wait. I need to connect the ground and shield. It's probably easier to do that first. So ground and shield goes right to ground. Okay, S bus not connected. So since these are not used, we just put an X over them. Now to figure out this thing. I forgot how to use it. Okay, I think I can close all these not required. Okay, I'll just go to my this one. The schematic. Oh, that's a flash memory, whoops. Okay. ESD protection. These are not connected. 5V. Ground. Okay. Okay. So... Right, I forgot to connect this here to 5V. 5V. So, like I explained earlier, anything that goes after the fuse, the polyfuse from the V bus turns into 5V. Anything before is VCC. So this is VCC. There we go. Chorus is IP? Wait, I have no idea what you guys are talking about. Okay, so here it goes to 5V, I believe. Yeah, I think it's 5V. Yeah, and then here goes to ground. IO2 should be D minus, is it? Oh, D plus. Okay, so this D plus, this is D minus. Be sure to get your... which one is which, correct? I have no idea how the ESD works. Like, I didn't read a data sheet for this or anything. So this is just me copying and like praying that shit works. Okay, this should be... Oh, C1 requires a 5.1K resistor. Does it? Let me check. Oh wait, it does. This, if you don't put the 5.1K resistors here, I think it means that you cannot flip the USB. Like, it only connects, like, in one orientation. If you know USB-C, you can flip it to whatever orientation, right? I think if you don't connect those resistors, right, you cannot flip it the other way and it won't detect. I think that's what happens. I can't remember. There was like a reason why they had the resistors there. Or like if you remove something, right, it will stop the polarity thing. Remember someone told me that like a while back, but I cannot remember like exactly right now. Okay, here we go. Just move this down here a little. Which keyboard are you using? It sounds good. Alright, you can hear my keyboard. Ado, it sounds so good. Okay, yeah. I'm using this one here. Okay, yeah, this one here. This is my current keyboard, my new one. Oh, come on, again? I already hit you. I used to use a Tofu 60. My Tofu 60 sounded like... it was somewhere here. I still have my Tofu 60. It's like in a bag right now. I haven't taken it out. It was... where's Keyboard Vortex? It was called Keyboard Vortex. Keyboard Vortex. No! 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 No, this is not it. Okay, I hate how unsearchable my channel is. It was somewhere. No, that was my old keyboard. Oh, this is a little too far back. Bruh, I can't find it. Yeah, here we go, this one, yeah. This was my old keyboard. Well, being on the sound voice controller made it talkier sounding, I guess. Yeah, Techno passed away. Alright, so this is 5.1k. Move. Okay, I believe we then connected to ground. Oh yeah, it's good PCB practice to make sure that all your ground symbols point down, and all your VCC and 5V symbols point up. That is very important. Don't rotate them. Make sure they point in the right directions. This is for basic schematic readability, I believe. What the fuck? Oh, why is it not connecting? Oh. Here we go. My God. What are you doing? Oh, they're not aligned anymore. I see. Oh, I changed the grid snapping to this. The grid snapping is different now. You know what? I'm too lazy to fix it back. Too lazy to change it, so I'm just gonna like roll with this, I guess. As long as it's connected, I guess. It's not connected! What the fuck? Yeah, I'm redoing this. Okay, now it's connected. Okay, now I just move these down. Okay. Alright, then connect it to ground. So we are done with the USB-C port. When you change grid snap, yep. I'm pretty bummed out, but when I saw his live stream and I thought I could relax, what's wrong? Oh, you mean the Technoblade? Yeah. I don't know how, but things are suddenly making a little sense to me. Thanks to grade 12 physics, I say. Yeah, it really helps. So this here helps with the, I think it helps with like the USB-C polarity or something, I have no idea. This one, the V-bus, it's converting VCC, going through the fuse to convert it to 5V. Not really converts per se, but it just makes sure that everything after this is definitely 5V. So if there's like a short or spike in voltage, this fuse here will protect the rest of your circuit. So this 5V goes right straight to here, into the microcontroller. And while it's going through microcontrollers, it goes through these decoupling capacitors so that it filters out the signal to make it all like nice and not noisy. And then it goes into the microcontroller. Micro USB is so much easier to wire, I swear. But I'm really lazy to wire up a micro USB right now, because I need to go check like how it's wired. I'm pretty sure I'll probably be able to figure it out if I just put in the symbol. Let me see. Micro B. USB B micro. Wow, USB 3 micro looks so complicated. Okay. Yeah, okay, this is a lot easier actually. This is like very simple. Okay, you're not doing that. Okay. Alright, so inside the microcontroller, I'll just explain again. It goes, the here is the crystal traces. This crystal here is the entire thing is called a crystal oscillator. It makes sure that everything is on time. It makes sure that the clock signals this stays in the same clock cycle, like the same, same timing for each clock. Oh. Was there like a notification? I heard something. Oh, hey, thanks for the 280, Ahito. Thank you so much. You donated through my Twitch. Thank you. Oh my, oh wait, wrong scene. Here we go. Thank you so much, Ahito. Hey, welcome to stream, Harry. I'm making a PCB. Alright, so right now, we're going to have something very simple. We will work on a... we're gonna add a few keys. How many keys do you guys want to add? So switch. MX switch. So do you want hot swap or soldered? Okay, we'll go with hot swap. So here. How many switches? We can go with 2. Alright, see you around, Ash. Okay, so first we're going to have a ground pins. So if you're doing something direct, wait, why is it not? Okay. So if you're doing something direct pin, which means that you are directly connecting the switch to an input, which means that one switch takes up one entire pin. In usual keyboards, we go with rows and columns. So one pin would be one entire row and one pin would be one entire column. But since we're only dealing with two switches, we can dedicate one entire pin to each switch. It's 1:19 your time. You're getting lost making this guide. No, I woke up at 10 p.m. today somehow. You know, I woke up today at... What time did I wake up? I think I woke up at like 6 a.m. And then I fell asleep at 1 p.m. and I woke up at 10 p.m. My sleep is fucked. Okay. So here, two switches. And then we can open up the PCB. So we click this button to go into the PCB. We go into Manage Footprint Libraries under Preferences because we need to make sure we load the footprints. So open the folder, Master Lib. We'll go into MX, select folder. And then we'll go into Various and select this folder. You know it's a footprint library when the folder ends with .pretty. Yeah. So we press OK and it should be all loaded. But basically, everything you see here, like this thing, they're called symbols. But in a PCB, all the things you see in there are called footprints. So that's how you distinguish between the two. But then first, what we're going to do is that we're not going to connect these switches first. We will route the PCB first. So next up, we're going to run the footprint assignment tool. We annotate the sheet. Sleep juice doesn't work. I would buy sleep juice right now, guys. But my grocery store doesn't sell sleep juice. Okay. So I'm going to search for capacitor SMD. And here we're going to write which one we are looking for. Let's work with 0402. This one for our C small. And as for the fuse, I think it's under fuse, right? Yeah, fuse. We're going to go with 1005. Okay, here's how to know which footprints to use. You check the numbers at the back of these. This is called the footprint size. And different footprint sizes mean different things. Like example, resistor footprint sizes. So you can see that each resistor size has different code names, and that's how you find out which code you want to use, because it's based on the size. Hand solderable would be at 0805 or bigger. So we're going to use 1005 for this. And resistor, we are also going to use 0402. And as for the switch, I forgot what the switch footprint is called. Okay, I think it's just push. Okay, I can't remember. Oh, was this the correct one? Oh no, that's my other schematic. I have to load another library. This is fun. I don't want to load another library. Okay, so we have another library we need to use. It's called random keyboard parts.pretty. Okay, let's load that in. So it's under PCB tutorial stream. We'll paste this here. Okay, I'm going to crystal would be under crystal. I think the one we're using is like, which one was it? Oh my god. SMD 3225, I believe. Yeah, 3225. 4 pins. And the switch. Okay, just apply schematic and save continue first. Okay. Go preferences, manage symbol libraries, project references. We're going to add random keyword parts. Schematic library. Okay. And then we're going to open up the assign footprint tool again. How do I enable autosave for the schematic editor? Wait, there's an autosave function. I didn't know that. Whoops. Okay, let me SKQ and then just take this out. So with stem. Apply, save, continue. Now time to open the PCB. Manage footprint libraries. And then we need to add the footprint for that button that we just added. Okay. Then we click this button to spit everything out onto the PCB. Alright, and this is our current PCB. Red means that it's facing up. If it's blue, it means it's facing down. So you can view 3D viewer right now. And you can see that everything here is on the upside. Then on behind, this one is facing back because this one is behind. So we're gonna just... do I want to bother? I guess most people usually flip it around. So... where is our... Oh wait, I forgot to assign a USB port. Whoops. Okay, let me assign a USB port. Okay, so we're gonna go to where is this? It was where is the C library again? Where is USB-C connector? Okay, wait, it was somewhere. Let me go find it. Okay. ASMR, this is honestly great just watching it. Wait, what do you mean? What am I looking at? I'm too much an idiot to understand. No. If you were here at the start of the stream, it would be a lot easier to understand because I went through all the basics already. You're kind of like watching a tutorial at the midway point. Okay, so under C... Oh, connector USB. Okay. So here, it's under connector, USB. So we're using the HRO type C. This is the standard one that everyone uses. We're going back here. We are going to update, press the button again to update. And here we go, we got the USB-C receptor. Okay. And then we're gonna press F to flip. And you can edit your user grid here. So you can set your own grid, user-defined grid, and then fast switching here. So this is the grid I set, 0.79375. The reason why I use this is because if I were to... Oh, whoops. Ah, come on. Okay. If I were to move this, it will move in this snapping-like fashion, and it will exactly snap how far you need for keys to be exactly next to each other on a normal keyboard. And go to sleep now. Alright. See you guys cloudless. Will the vault for this stream be saved? Yes, it will be. Okay, so we're gonna move this down. So this should be in the middle. Yep, it's in the middle. It was in the middle. Okay, just move this up. Okay. Then next up. Okay, so when you see these gray lines, it means that things need to be connected. Let me just move... okay, this here definitely needs to be moved. The ESD protection should be close to the USB. And, okay. Then next up, I think I'm going to change it to the smallest now. Alright, by the way. I'm going to make this small. Here we go. When I click something here, it will teleport to where the item is on the schematic. This is really easy for referencing. Yeah, this is really helpful. Okay, so right now, I'm going to go to here. This needs to be connected to the data traces. So I'm gonna move this here. No, I believe this should be here. And this needs to be flipped upside down. Okay, then next up we're going to find the other one. So when it comes to routing, it's all about like, it's kind of like a logic problem solving kind of deal. It's a bit difficult, but you get the hang of it. It's quite fun, in my opinion. It's like learning a puzzle. I mean, it literally tells you where to connect things because there's like lines across telling you how to connect. And this is not AutoCAD. It's not. Alright, see you around, Gura. Okay, man, do I really want to like route this entire thing? Wait, how long have I been streaming? Oh, it's been an hour. Okay. I'm really lazy to teach like PCB design right now, man. Like schematic? Okay. Routing? Okay, here we go. Okay, let's change this to where the data traces is. You can see here which area is which. Where's the data trace supposed to be connected to? Okay, let me check. You can use here, put line. Okay, so up here like this. Okay, I'm gonna put this up here. You should make a GitHub so that Lotus Man can steal it. What are you talking about? Will you save this tutorial after the stream is over? Yes. So that, you know, people can reference such a thing later on. Wait. Where is... This one is connected to... Right here. Oh, there's curve traces. Nope. Oh my god, what is this? Okay, let me check my schematic. Oh, these aren't connected, no wonder! Oh, they're not aligned anymore! Grid snap! Oh my god. Grid snapping. Okay. I remember pressing N on my keyboard and it changed the grid snap. Okay. Now to update the PCB. Like some of these measures are nothing related to what you're doing. What are you talking about? I mean, it's normal. People can use this place to chat. Okay, so we can see the pins here, the external pins are on this side. So we should move this here. Here we go. Like so. And this one is... We'll move this here. And we'll move... Oh my god, this is quite messy. Okay. Oh, why is this here? Okay. I'm gonna remove those messages. They're really annoying. We can see from here, I'm looking for external one, C1. So this should go here. And this is the reset button, which should be connected to a resistor. Which resistor is it connected to? R1, okay. So this is here. This one is connected to R1 as well. Okay. Okay, we'll move this here. Connect this. Connect these together. And for the ground pins, we connect this here. This to ground. Alright, gonna sleep before it hits 2-3 a.m. Alright, good night, Mr. Sleepy. Alright, see you around, Harry, as well. Okay. Now for this one, this is connected to. Oh, these two must be for the... This one is for the USB-C port on the two sides. I'll put this here. Okay, the easiest one to do first is connect the grounds together. So ground, 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 ground. And then these are connected here. This is connected here. Oh, that's quite ugly traces, aren't they? Okay, I'll move this a little lower then. Okay, like this. Okay, I want VCC here. Which means that I should move this a little. But VCC will be stuck inside. Because if I connect these two together... Then I can't get this thing out. Bruh. I can put a VR. Oh. Okay. is what you call a moment. Hey, welcome to stream, Odals. Alright, I guess I'll just delete these. I have VCC coming from this side. Because 5V is here. Okay. So VCC is connected to the fuse. So we'll connect these two together. And this to here. And this one, I'll put a via here. And connect it here to here. Oh, these traces don't look very pretty, do they? Alright, like that. And then D plus to D plus. D minus. I'll have to use a via here. Oh. Okay. What is AutoCAD? What is KiCad doing? Oh my, okay. Alright, if they wanna be like that, I guess I'll have to shift that downwards again. Okay. Alright, like this. So I have to put this here. Here to here. Cause if I'm not wrong, you are forced to use one via on the data traces for on Mega32U2. If not, that the PCB will not fit at all. it won't reach the pins properly. Oh. Okay, so these are data traces, which means that you need to make sure that they are differential. Differential meaning that the traces are of the same length, so you need to make sure that they are close together and they are like looking like this, basically. So, okay, now disconnected to the ground. 5V, VCC. Alright. There's a spare trace here. Okay. So, if I'm not wrong, the 10UF... Okay, wait, let me save this. The 10UF, which should be here, C6, should be close to the VCC. Okay, so here. Oh. I should put the silk screen further away so that you can see them. Okay. Resistor here. Here we go. Like that. Ground here. Okay. Now this should be connected to... Let me check the data sheet real quick. This is really important, checking data sheets. Alright, best for a VBUS line. Alright, so I'll put it very closely to the top here. Then as for... Now I need to find... Okay, I'll connect the traces here together first. I can connect these two together. These are some ugly SL traces. If I'm not wrong, when it comes to routing the crystal, you need to make sure the crystal traces are as short as possible to the PCB. Okay, so I'll just put that there, and I'll route this here, and then I'll route this here. There we go. Something about this looks kind of ugly, but whatever. It clears the clearance, I guess. Okay, there's a spare trace here. Alright, let's see, what else? Okay, this is for the VCC pins. So I'll have to put them close to the VCC pins. It's very important for your decoupling caps to be close to the VCC. Yes. So I'll connect these two 5Vs together. Wait. Is there any other 5V? Yeah, this one 5V here. So This one is connected to 5V as well. Oh, that's touching. I mean, technically it's not. It's within the clearance. You can see the clearance on the borders here. All right, here we go. Go look at my channel, make sure things going well. All right, see around drum middle. Okay. Now this one is the UCAP, I believe. All right, UCAP. All right, UCAP. So here we go. I'm just gonna put this here. Because I want space here to move to the switches. All right, so I'm gonna move this here to ground. Oh, that's not good. Okay, I guess I'll leave the trace here, and I'll figure it out later. Here, okay. Then I gotta move this here. Oh, then I should probably move this. There we go. This should be differential. Okay. Now to connect the 5Vs together. Is this connected? Okay. Decoupling caps should have all of the 5Vs connected properly. Ah, this thing is going to connect to the 5V, bruh. Okay, so an easy way to get your 5V down is to... Alright, we just got to connect this big boy down here, down first. Okay, fuse. Oh, that's hitting the clearance, bruh. Okay. There should be a way to get it down there. I don't want to move this thing. It's like perfectly in the middle. Should have gone the other side. But I can't flip it over. So... Yeah, this is why PCB designing is a bit like... I would say it's like problem solving, yeah? Alright, see you around, Lemon. Okay, so putting it down here, it seems like a terrible idea. Okay, I believe I can probably VR this. Yeah, I'll probably just use a VR. Why not? So I'll VR... I'll probably put this down here. And then VR it downwards. At the same time, I can make a via. Oh, I don't want to cross the data traces. All right. So here to here to here to. About here. Oh my. Okay, I have to move the crystal a bit further back. Because I need space for the VR. Okay. They say as short as possible. This is as short as it can be. So, no harm done. Alright, just delete this. Get this connected here. Okay. Okay, I think here I can add a via. Okay. Then here, connecting here. And this can be connected here. This ground here. Okay, what else? Alright, then this one here should be connected here. There we go. So we should have all the five Vs connected. Now we just need to connect all the grounds together. There's an easy way to do this. So first things first, I'm going to draw the go on the edge cuts and draw the edge cut of the board. Like that. I'll move this a little higher. Like so. And then I'll move this down. Oh. Okay, this switch here is getting in the way. I'll just put it aside. Alright. So, hey, welcome to stream, Kino. Alright, so now we have the... This is a really weird looking... Yeah, I should probably redo this. Okay, I'll just redo with lines, like proper lines. Yeah, proper lines. Can I add a corner? No, I can't. Okay. I hate drawing edge cuts. Usually you do like a guideline to make sure that like you do under like your user drawings and comments, try your best to make it all like proper. But I am lazy. Okay, let me just change the grid, I guess. And I'll place the origin to here, I guess. That's a little far away. Let me place the origin like here. Okay, that seems right. Okay. So, draw a line. Up here. Down here. Wait, here. Stop snapping. Okay, about here. Then I will connect these two lines together. Make sure they snap. And I can delete this. And now we should have the edge cuts done. So this should look nice. We're doing PCB for the keypad? No, I'm just... This is a tutorial on how to route a simple PCB on keycad. Alright, so the ground... It's not connected. But there's a very easy way to get the ground connected without doing all kinds of, routing them together. You could just connect them directly like I did here. But that can be quite messy. So you could just insert a ground fill with this button here. So we just go here, BCU on the back of the keyboard, use ground. I'm just going to use a fillet. And solid. So here. Okay. Then we press B to fill. And now we can see that all the ground is connected properly. And that's good. Now we have a PCB that's fully finished. I forgot to connect the ground here. Oh, this ground is not connected to... Oh, whoops. Okay. You press this button to don't show the ground fill. Yep, it's just routing in general. I forgot to connect the ground of the PCB to... to the USB port. Okay. I think I can connect it. What's a nice way to connect this, actually? I legit have no clue. Okay. Like that? Let's see. Oh, that's an ugly trace. Okay, that should fix it. Press B to fill again. And, okay, everything is connected now. Good. So, now we need to figure out where to connect these two, to here. Sheesh. Okay, I think I'll use this pin here, and I'll use this pin here. because I'm very lazy to use a lot of vias. I don't want to use so many vias on this board. To be honest, I could just move everything on the bottom further up, can't I? So I can make a really small keypad, actually. Yeah, I could. Oh well, whatever. I'm really lazy to change how the edge cuts look. This is just an example. Alright, so we can see here this is pin 25 and pin 26. So we're moving to here. And we'll find pin 25. We're going to add a label. We're going to name it a key. I guess call 1, call 0 would work. Technically, it's not a column, but that's okay. So the next one, 26. Here. Call 1. We're going to go back here, copy, paste. Is it correct? This is switch. Switch 2, switch 3. Okay, so we should move this one here. And then column 1. We're almost done with the keypad already. Okay, save. Reload. Wait, what did I put here? It's column 1. I have to use a VR through here. Do I really want to do that? Technically, you want to have as little things crossing through the data traces as much as possible. I don't wanna. I mean, technically, okay, so in the scenario where you have to cross through your data traces, you have to make sure that you are crossing them. That you are crossing them in a, how do I put this? You need to cross them perpendicularly. So, I guess I'll be crossing the data traces. So, I need a via here. Oh, I can't add a via here. Sheesh, shit. Okay, then I need to move this 5V. Clearances are causing some issues. Alright, here. Okay. Oh, this angle here is kind of ugly, actually. I don't want to make this that ugly. Okay. There, like that. Okay, that looks a bit better. Okay, now I should be able to put a VR here. So if you're putting a VR, make sure you cross like completely straight across. Okay. Now this means that we can... Bruh. This thing is in the way. Wait, let's see if I can still route it though. Ugh. That's ugly. That's really ugly. I mean, I should probably move shift this a bit more. But do I wanna though? I can. So I guess I'll move this straight ahead, I guess. Shouldn't be too hard. There we go. There, like that. Okay, then after that, this one is simple. We just route it like that. This is a little ugly. Here we go. And then B to fill again. And you can see now everything is connected. We're going to add one more ground fill. What's the shortcut to insert a VR and change copper layer during wiring? Okay, inserting a VR is V. To change copper layer during wiring, that's just something that happens immediately when you use a VR. Okay, so I'm going to add a ground fill on the front. So fill it solid. So we're just gonna add this here. I didn't add any LEDs in this tutorial. Adding addressable LEDs are Kind of straightforward, I'd like to think. Addressable LEDs, they're not too bad to wire. As long as you know how they're connected electrically, it should be fine. Okay, so press B. And then we are going to run the design rules checker, the DRC. So I'm going to run DRC, see if there's anything. And zero errors. And okay, so there's a lot of errors for unconnected tracks. And that's because of the extras. These are extra wires. I believe there's a way to remove these tracks immediately. Wait. Oh, there's quite a lot of unconnected wires. Okay. Oh, okay, this thing here is clipped by the silk screen. Let me just move that. Oh, this one is clipped as well. Let me just move these so that they can be seen on the PCB. And then C4. Oh my god, C4 is underneath the MCU. Okay, I'll put it here. R1 here. No, why did it give me 4 errors? Oh, that's a lot of errors. Okay, U1. Oh, that one's blocked. I'll put it here. Okay, so run DRC. And I still have more unconnected tracks. This one is cut, but I don't care. It's fine. Because I want this port to be... Wait. It's probably better if I move this line above, actually. Yeah, it's probably better if I move it a little higher. Okay. Okay, then I should probably move the zones higher up as well. The fill zones. It would be really funny if someone from Lolo was watching the stream and actually taking notes. Nah, I doubt it. I'm back by making a 2K. Yeah, it's a 2K tutorial. Are you planning on selling keypads in the future? Yes. But another 2K. Okay, so fill in the zones with B. And then I'm gonna save. And now time to run the DRC one more time. Just to see if there's any errors. Zero errors. Alright, all good. So now we can 3D viewer. And this is how our keypad looks like. It is a nice small keypad. Very simple. No LEDs. Hot swap. Everything should check out. And that is it. This is how you make a simple 2-key PCB. It is a lot easier than it looks, doesn't it? Oh, you can see there's a ground island here. Like here it's not filled by ground. So when that happens, what you can do is you can insert a ground via there. So I'm just going to put via. Oh, no. Let me just... Ground via. Okay. I'm just going to delete this. Copy this, paste it here. This is a really scuffy way to fix it, but okay, B. And now when we view, we should have that part filled. Yep, this is how you feel undone islands. All right, so let me just preferences, and then I will colors. I will, how do I reset to default? There's no option to reset to default, but okay, whatever. I put it green then. It was like 80, 87, I think. All right, so this should be the normal color. Yeah, this is the normal PCB color. All right. Hey guys, do you know that this thing has ray tracing? Do you need to fill ground islands? Well, it's good practice on a two-layer PCB, I believe. It's Zykra gave me a good reason why, but I forgot what they told me. Let me check. Because I asked the exact same thing. Here we go. It's ground stitching. Most two-layer keyboards don't have proper ground layers and planes, so a bunch of traces generally get in the way of the return signal. The return signal follows the path of least inductance, which is generally right under or next to the main signal trace. If you stitch your ground fills on both sides of the PCB, it generally allows the return signals to return better without putting in too much thought into how to route the ground traces or whatever. I see. Yeah, so this here is the explanation to why you would want to fill in ground islands. And, well, add more ground stuff. And, oh my PC is dying. Ray tracing. But yes, this is the final work. And I hope you guys learned a lot today. How to route a PCB. So, it's not too hard to route. There's the way you can do it with rows and columns. Rows and columns would be different. All right, I should probably upload this tutorial to GitHub. So I guess I'll open GitHub. New repo, PCB tutorial stream. Documents, GitHub, here we go. Okay. Let me just publish this repo first. Oh wait, there's no commit to main here because I guess it's just everything. Alright. I didn't learn anything because I came halfway through. It's alright. I'll save this VOD. Okay, so I'll show you guys real quick under here. This was the thing I was supposed to be working on, but I ended up spending like 2... How long was I streaming? Yeah, 2 hours. On, you know. Teaching you guys how to PCB design instead of working on this. So yeah, here, this is how rows and columns would work instead. So you have one row connected to every single like switch here, and then columns here. So like a giant matrix. So this is what it is. So here, on here, you will connect the rows and columns instead of the individual switches itself. Because on this MCU, there's definitely not enough pins for 80 keys to direct pin every single thing. And yeah, that's pretty much it. How are return signals affected by the ground area or the lack of that they come across? Is it static? Okay, so the return signals that Zykra was talking about, it's not talking about the ground areas. He's talking about the return signals off the ground areas. Like, in an ideal world, and how electricity works is that it will take the path of least resistance and you should route them with like the shortest or the most direct trace possible for the ground. Except the thing is, we only have 2 layers on the PCBs that we're working on. So this means that we only have the top and bottom. Most of the time, well, other PCBs use 4 layers, which means that you could have one layer that is just for power and the other layer is just for ground. So you can route the traces as short as possible. But since we only have 2 layers, which is top and bottom, this means that we have to deal with the ground with everything else. So with ground fill, we don't need to worry about connecting the traces as directly as possible. Like, if there wasn't a ground fill here, I will have to slowly route the ground to the top here and try my best to figure out what's the shortest and most direct path it can take. But when you use ground fill, everything is ground. So the electricity itself will just like take the shortest path possible, the most efficient route. And that's basically ground filling, I think. So that's, so I thought when you added more vias for ground fill, it helps with the reliability of the ground signal, but no, it doesn't. So when I add a ground fill here, it's so that in case any ground needs to use that ground path for the shortest area, that's why you fill in the islands as well. Why does ground need a short route? Oh man, this is a question that's out of my capability to explain. I actually don't know why. Alright, see you around, Sashi. I imagine when it comes to electronics in general, you want all traces to be as short as possible because that will be the most reliable and the quickest and the best way for all your PCBs. And yeah, so I was supposed to be working on this earlier, but I ended up getting distracted. This is TKL. I use curve traces here. If you're ever interested in using curve traces, you can, on the latest KiCad version, you can select here and then fillet tracks. So I put 7 and it will fillet it. Not 7.3, it was 6.7. Then here will be 6.4. And this one will be 6.1. And yeah, that's how you curve traces. Pretty neat, isn't it? Alright, and that's it for the stream today. I think I ended up streaming 2 hours for a tutorial. I think I'm quite tired. Instead of routing this now, I think I'll just take a break instead. So, thank you guys for coming. See you guys next time.